Good morning. We're going to give everyone a few more minutes to join and then we'll begin. As a reminder, your mics have been muted and your camera icons have been disabled to allow full attention to our speakers today. A couple minutes and we'll get started. Thank you. Good afternoon and good morning to those of you who are on the West Coast. As a reminder, we invite you to learn more about our extensive backgrounds or the extensive backgrounds on our speakers by visiting our event website. The full bios are posted there. Hello and welcome to day three of our Gender Diversity Symposium. We're glad to have you with us. My name is Felicia Klein, and I work with the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond as a consumer affairs central point of contact for large bank holding companies. I'll be your MC for today. And today's discussion is the intersection of innovation and inclusion. So be sure to note references to those throughout each session throughout the day or this afternoon, and the awards presentation later on as well. Our first guest for today is Nancy Foster, who many of you were introduced to yesterday during her post-COVID How to Win with Women in the Boardroom session. So for those who weren't able to join us, I'd like to reintroduce to some and introduce to others, Nancy. Nancy is the president and CEO of the Risk Management Association, also known as RMA, where she's responsible for developing and implementing the strategic direction, as well as providing oversight for overall operations. RMA serves about 2,200 financial institutions and 18,000 professionals with 110 chapters worldwide. Prior to joining RMA, Nancy's former roles have included EVP with Park Sterling, CRO of CIT Group Incorporated, and Group SVP at LaSalle Bank Corporation. Nancy is a member of the WSFS Financial Corporation and also of the Pacific Coast Banking School Board of Directors. With that, Nancy, thank you again for joining us today, and I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Felicia, and welcome everyone to the final day of the Business Case for Change, Gender Diversity and Leadership in the Boardroom and C-Suite. And wow, what a great conference this has been. I know, like me, you've learned even more about this important topic from our speakers that we've had, and more to learn this afternoon. But Michelle Bowman and Tom Barker really helped shed light on the importance of diversity in the community bank sector in their keynote. And as always, when I speak with Jen and Terry from Bank on Women, I walk away blown away by the data and inspired by their commitment to change. One of the topics that Jen and Terry touched on yesterday was the importance of innovation in our industry and how diversity drives innovation. So today we'll have a chance to learn from some very motivational leaders on this topic. The first session, Banking of the Future, Integrating Innovation and Inclusion, features Philippa Girling, the Chief Risk Officer of Varo Bank. Varo Bank is uniquely focused on providing fair access to financial services for all and is the first fintech to receive a national bank charter. Talk about diversity and innovation. I am so fortunate to have Philippa on our board at RMA and can tell you firsthand that she is a powerful speaker who is always a source of new ideas. She has over 25 years of experience in finance and was recognized as one of the top 50 faces in risk in 2006 by the Organizational Risk and Compliance Magazine, and as one of the top 100 working mothers in America in 2014 by Working Mother magazine. I can't wait to hear what advice Philippa has for us today. The afternoon session features four current and former bank directors talking about how they bring diversity to life in their organization. And this will be a great note to go out on, giving us all new practical advice for our own firms. Please join us for these sessions and the award ceremony that will close out the day. On behalf of RMA, I want to thank our co-sponsors, the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond and Bank on Women, for this commitment to this very important topic and for putting together a truly great conference. And with that, we will turn it over to Philippa.
Thank you very much, Nancy. Always a pleasure to be sharing a podium with you, even if virtually. So thank you for the invitation to speak to you today. This is a topic I'm quite passionate about. I'm going to share some slides that I have. I'm just going to pull those up right now and then share my screen. So just give me one moment. Looks like I am unable to share my screen. So Felicia, are you able to pull up the slides that I put into the email for you?
We will get that going for you in 1 minute.
Thank you. And while that's happening, I'll just start with introducing myself. So I am now a Cali girl. You may guess from my accent, I wasn't originally a Cali girl. I came to the States in 1996, which is such a long time ago now. I keep thinking the late 90s were around the corner, but actually I heard someone refer to them recently as the late 1900s, which I found very depressing. And so I came here in the late 1900s, and I've been working in banking for over 25 years now. And I'm going to talk to you today about why I made a move away from the traditional banking I was working in into Varo, because I think it really touches on this topic. Like, what is banking of the future? How do we integrate innovation and inclusion? And if you could go to the next slide for me, please, Felicia. So I'm going to start with thinking about why am I where I am today? And I'm where I am today because I had several aha moments. And I think the women who are in the audience here will recognize some of these aha moments. And the men in the audience here will probably have observed some of these aha moments in their colleagues. So let me talk you through a few of them. And then we'll get into the topic of why that means that we need to have innovation and inclusion hand in hand. So here's my situation. I have been working in risk now since around 2004. And I've been working in banking since about 1994. And I was sitting in a meeting just a few years ago in the boardroom, surrounded by my executive colleagues, and I found myself banging my fist on the table. Now, I'm generally an introvert. You won't see me shouting and screaming and banging my fist on the table, but there I was, physically banging my fist on the table because I was trying to answer a question that had been posed to me about my area that I was able to answer, and two men were answering it on my behalf. Now, there's nothing wrong with having people weigh in to help you with what you're trying to do, but in that moment, I realized that being heard was still a struggle at the executive table, and that the level of energy that I have to bring every day just to be heard because of these unconscious biases that continue to exist in organizations, it's kind of wearing. And so I looked at these two guys, and then I looked around the table and I saw there was one other woman at the table. There were no people of color. And in fact, the table was almost entirely older, straight, white men. Now, I have nothing against older, straight, white men. I married one, I love him. They are wonderful. But when you're trying to innovate, when you're trying to come up with new ways of thinking and doing something, you need diversity in the room. And you need to not just have the diversity in the room, but you need to be able to hear from them. So inclusion isn't about bringing people to the table. Inclusion is about letting them speak. And so I realized in that moment, I still am struggling past this first step of inclusion, and I'm exhausted by it. So that was my first aha moment that made me think I need to make a change. The second aha moment for me was I realized that I'd been pushing for innovation in several of the roles that I'd held, trying to do it from the risk seat. Now, from the risk seat, really what I should be doing is saying, slow down, everybody. That's crazy talk. It's dangerous. Let's talk through the risks. But instead, I was finding myself quite often having conversations along the lines of, let's go to the cloud. Let's think about digital. And it fell off to me. And I wanted to find an environment where I would be stretched so that instead of trying to draw innovation along in the company, I would be running to catch up. I was much healthier at my age and with my experiences that I shouldn't actually be leading innovation. I should be looking to others who are more in touch with what is available right now, and I should be running to catch up. And I looked at innovation and the way that it happens in most traditional banks and legacy banks, and this is what you tend to see. There'll be a lab, an innovation or digital lab set up somewhere, usually in the San Francisco Bay Area, tends to be where it is. And in that lab, everyone gets to wear jeans and t-shirts, and they have free kombucha and granola snacks. And there might even be a teepee for ideation moments and snack chairs and sleeping chairs. This is all normal in San Francisco. And I can attest to the fact, completely normal. Now, in that environment, actually, those labs could come up with really great innovation. And I found in some of the legacy institutions that I've worked in, those labs had fabulous innovative ideas. And what they would then do is send them back to the mothership. And when it arrived back at headquarters, it would be bolted on the outside, like barnacles on the outside of the ship. It was never truly transformative all the way from the inside out of the organization. It tended to be surface innovation. And that's not because people weren't interested in full innovation. It's because the tech debt, the process debt, the policies and procedures debt that exists in a legacy organization is really hard to get past. It's difficult to start from scratch. So at that point, when I was having my aha moments a few years ago, I realized maybe the only way to truly innovate is to start from scratch. If you look at Uber, you look at Airbnb, you look at Netflix, these are all organizations that have completely transformed their industry by starting from scratch. They looked at what technology is available today. If I was to build this product or service today, how would I build it? And that is really how they won in their space. And so at the time when I was having my aha moments, I was thinking maybe the only way to truly innovate in digital banking is to start from scratch. Now, I'm not saying that you have to do that because obviously a traditional bank cannot, but we'll come back to that to say, how can you effectively start from scratch? So those two pressures were moving me to try and make a change from being in a traditional banking role, in a traditional risk role in a traditional bank. Third one was a little more personal. So at this point, all my children, I have lots of children, so all my children had left home. I was now empty nesting, and I looked at the choices that my children had made, and they have made some really, really interesting choices, daring choices that I would not have made in my 20s. One of them is in Berlin, being a photographer. One of them is in Vienna, being a writer. One of them is New Orleans, doing an edtech startup. One of them is in New York, working in banking. One of them is a designer working for an advertising agency. And I looked at these choices that they'd made. And it became really clear to me at that moment that they were able to make those choices. And they were able to make those choices because they had privilege. And they had privilege because I had privilege. And I looked at some of their closest friends, dear friends of theirs, who could not make those same choices because they did not have that same privilege. And just as I was having these aha moments around, is this really the environment I want to operate in? Is this really the innovation that I want to be aligned with? I also thought, can I really only be part of the problem? Or can I find a way, even if it's just a small way, to be part of redressing the systemic imbalance that exists today between privilege and underprivilege in this country? And so those three things drove me to think, I would like to find a role that is more inclusive, more innovative, and is bringing about change. And just as I made this decision, I actually handed in my notice with a very long notice period in my job, and I got a phone call from Varo. 2 weeks after I made this decision. So the phone call was along these lines. Hi, this is Colin Walsh. I am the CEO at Varo Money. We're a fintech and we would like, well, we intend to become a bank. I have a completely diverse management team and board, and a diverse board is really unheard of in banking at the moment still. And we are going to build everything from scratch. We are cloud native. We're using a whole new core system and technology approach to the way we deliver our products. It will be digital only. And our mission is to bring about fair access to financial services products to people who have been unfairly denied that access. Would I be interested in coming and joining to set up the risk management function so that we could get a national charter? This was in 2019. My response was, yes, I would be interested, and please can I be a founder? And so I joined Varo as a founder of Varo Bank and as the chief risk officer, and that was in March 2019. And so now, if you'd like to go to the next slide, please, Felicia. Okay, so then when you summarize all of these things that I had been thinking through, here was the conclusion that I had come to, is that in order to have true inclusion and in order to have real innovation, you have to have diverse voices around the table. Now, I don't know how many of you might recognize this, but I have over the years had advice from people around how to show up effectively as a woman in the workplace. Now, if I go all the way back to the late 1900s, in the 1990s, one of the early memories I have of that kind of influence was I got a really ghastly haircut when I was in my 20s that was a page boy, very, very short, not intended. And I went back to the office the next day and I was working in the legal department of a large insurance firm. And the senior partner pulled me into his office and he said, if you want to be a lawyer, as a woman, you can't have that haircut in the office. I remember being really shocked at the time, thinking, really? It's like, that's not appropriate. Now, go forward about 4 years, and the first roles I had working in financial services, once I graduated college, there were rules that you could not wear trousers. Women were not allowed to wear trousers in the office. It was inappropriate. Now, we have come a long way since then. I will say, hand on heart, you can have any haircut you want. You can wear trousers. Actually, now we're all remote, you can wear sweatpants. So things have moved on. But there's still this underlying sense of you need to change yourself in order to fit in. And in the last 10 to 15 years, I would say, a lot of the advice that I've heard is how to show up with the same empowerment as the men around you. And here's some of the advice you may have heard. Throw your shoulders back. Put your hands on your hips in the Superman pose. If you really need people to listen, lower your voice. They can hear you better when you speak in a lower frequency. Don't apologize. Be sure to be firm in the way that you state your opinions. These are all bits of advice that I've heard. Basically, this advice is be more like a man. Now, that is not diversity. So what I would say about that is we have been encouraged, and this is true of all minority groups, we've been encouraged to show up in the way that mirrors the current power paradigm in order to have power. And I now believe in a completely different premise. I now believe that we should not change, but we should change the rules. Because what's important is that everybody shows up authentically as themselves. That's where inclusion works. If you're asking someone to come to the table, but to behave like the people who are already at the table, you haven't introduced diversity. It's exactly the same as it was before. And so I lean into how do we embrace difference and bring it to the table with a voice and do that with ourselves as well. You know, we are much more effective as leaders. We're much more effective as decision makers when instead of trying to change our natural authentic self, we change the rules to embrace that authentic self. So this is my new mantra, don't change, change the rules. Now, what I don't mean here is if you have a really bad habit, don't change that habit. That's not what I mean. Of course, we can all evolve and grow and become stronger and better leaders. But if there's something that's authentically you, it's okay for that authenticity to remain. And actually it has real value at the table. And this is where innovation can become really exciting. Now, having said that, if you'd like to go to the next slide, Felicia. Yes, we want to change the rules. And I think part of this conversation and the whole conference is what are some of the underlying rules that we want to change in order to promote innovation and inclusion. And here's one thing I think we need to stop and stare at quite frequently, is that change has to go through the change curve. Nobody skips the change curve. And what I have learned over the years is that if I'm going to bring about organizational change or some hierarchy change, any change, is to have a really open conversation with the people who will be impacted to say, you are going to have emotions when we go through this change. And those emotions are valid and appropriate and normal. And so there's nothing wrong with the fact that you're feeling shocked or in denial about this change. There's actually nothing wrong with the fact that you might be quite angry that this change is happening and you want to blame somebody for why this change had to happen. And it's also not unusual for you want to bargain. Okay, well, I'll make this change if you'll also do this for me. And it's also not unusual for you to feel a bit exhausted by the whole thing and just to sink into apathy. But eventually, you will make it around to accepting that this change is appropriate and exploring how it can be really effective and how it can drive great decision-making and innovation and advancement for your organization. Eventually, you'll understand it and integrate it, and it will become a sustainable part of your company. So when I say don't change the rules, I also accept the fact that changing the rules is not easy. And within your own organization, even within your own self, when you're trying to think about, well, how do I change the rules to allow for more innovation, allow for more inclusion, you need to let people go through this curve. And some people will whiz right around it because they love change, and some people will take months. And some people will never make it round. And if somebody's not going to make it round this change cycle at all, then it may be that they're not going to fit into the future of banking. So I would challenge people, find a way to get around the curve. Now, for those who are involved in trying to bring about change, those of you who are trying to drive innovation in your organization and drive inclusion in your organization, there are real tangible ways to help people around this change curve. On the left-hand side, a lot of what's happening here requires information. You need to engage people in conversation. You need to provide them with the background for why this change is important, how it's going to be beneficial for them, how they can be part of this change. If you try and implement change without that discussion, you might find people get stuck. So for example, if you decided we are going to set diversity metrics in our company, and we're going to require that we hit a certain target at some point. If you just put that out there as a statement, you're going to find people stuck on the left-hand side. What you need to do is have a conversation that says, why do we want to do that? What are the drivers for why that is the right thing for us to do and the right thing for you to be a part of? And the same with innovation. If you're going to come up with a whole new way of designing products, so for example, you're moving from a traditional waterfall approach to an agile approach. You can't just announce, we're going to be agile, get on board. That's not going to land well. What you have to do instead is say, here's the advantages of us becoming agile. Here's how we're going to provide you with the training and support so that you can be successful in this new environment. Here's some pilots, here's some experiments, and help people round that curve. If you'd like to go to the next slide, Felicia. Okay, so let's say we have helped people round the curve and we've really focused on how to get inclusion and innovation at the heart of the organization. I would then say there's a challenge to people who are themselves working in risk function in particular for me, but in whatever area you're in, to ask ourselves, have we embraced a growth mindset? Now, Karen Dweck has a really great book on mindset. And really the heart of growth mindset is, do you get your self-esteem from what you already know? Or do you get your self-esteem from where you can go? To summarize it. So a fixed mindset would say, I am a really great chief risk officer because I have worked in banking for 25 years and I know lots about risk disciplines and how to set up frameworks. You're so lucky to have me because I know that. That's a fixed mindset. When I say that, my self-esteem comes from what I already know. And the danger with that is that then how am I going to feel when I realize that some of what I know is wrong? It actually becomes part of dealing with your self-esteem. So to change becomes really difficult if you have a fixed mindset, because you're kind of rooted in my worth comes from what I already know and do. Now, a growth mindset says, yeah, I have this tool belt of skills that are going to be really useful for you, but what I can do really well is go on the journey with you. I'm going to be able to come on this journey with you and stretch myself and learn so that we can do things in a new way. Now, in the world that we're in right now with digital approaches and huge changes in the way that our customers interact with us, we have to be ready to embrace a growth mindset. And here's the good news. You can learn a growth mindset. It's not that you're born with a fixed mindset or born with a growth mindset, not at all. You can actually do experiments with your team. And I've done some of these exercises with my team where you can show them that they actually can develop a growth mindset. It's a skill set, you can grow. And so work has to be done within the teams to help with that growth mindset. Do the work with your teams to discover how they can develop that growth mindset, lean into it. In the risk management function at Varo, one of the key questions I ask in interviews, and this is a hint in case anyone wants to interview at some point, is I always dig to see if someone has a growth mindset. And usually what I ask them is, can you give me an example of when you have been forced to use a growth mindset and it has felt uncomfortable for you and how that went? And usually in response to that, I will get a sense from someone whether they are never going to want to get into their discomfort zone or whether they have actually jumped right in to difficult situations and worked their way through it using a growth mindset. Okay, if you'd like to go to the next slide, Felicia. Okay, so we have talked about how inclusion is just a necessary element of innovation because it brings all those perspectives to the table, but let's talk a little bit more about that. Now, there have been many studies on the power of a diverse team. And some of the ones that I found most interesting are where you have a diverse team that actually has a lower IQ than the non-diverse team and consistently outperforms the non-diverse team, which shows that there is something deeply powerful about a diverse team where we are better than our individual selves. We are smarter than our individual selves. And so it's very important that we find ways to have diverse teams. Now, so if we start first with employees, I'm sure you have heard people say it's very difficult to find diverse candidates. Just because it's difficult doesn't mean it can't be done. And I always push back on that. And I had one conversation where I was sitting in an executive team and one of the organizations I was in, and we went through the whole performance, 360 degree performance review. And we finished this review on all of our plus ones. So we had our own team and then the plus one directs. And it took days to go through this. It was very valuable, excellent work. At the very end of all of this work, I said to the team, I would just like to note that we have no diversity in our teams. And one of the people said to me, I don't know what you mean. There is three women. Like, yeah, so three women out of 35 is not diverse. And I actually wasn't talking about gender diversity. And then one of the other senior managers said, oh, I think she means race. It's like, I do mean race. We have no people of color in our plus ones organization. And the reaction in the room was extremely uncomfortable. And what I heard from one of the leaders was, well, it's really hard to find diverse candidates. And I said, look, it may be hard to find diverse candidates, but why is it that we never hire diverse candidates? And I'm going to push us to say we need to do better. And we need to do better because it's the right thing to do. And by the way, when we do it, the company will do better because it is consistently demonstrated that diversity throughout the organization, especially at the higher levels of the organization, produce better returns. It's actually financially the right business choice. So with my own team, I've had to build the team in Varo from quite small to much larger as we opened the bank. We got the charter last summer, and now we're operating as a bank, and there's some growth we've had to do. So I had some conversations with the recruiting team to say, I need to see more diversity in the hiring. And what I heard was, well, they're really hard to find. So that's okay. We're not hiring anyone else until you find me at least 50% of the candidates who come from a diverse background. I want to see inclusion. We want LGBTQIA plus inclusion. We want people of color. We want Latina and Latinx. We want to see Asian Americans. I want to see diversity in this team. Because a challenge with being in San Francisco and Salt Lake City is actually not that much natural diversity in the work environment. So we need to go find it. And we did. And now we do have a very diverse team, and I can feel the team effectiveness going up. The more diversity we bring in, you can just feel the vibrancy of bringing diverse views to the table. And now I feel we will better serve our customers because we have that diverse team. So then another one to consider is, well, what about your partners? Do you look at your third parties and see whether we are only hiring third parties that come from particular demographics or backgrounds? Would it be beneficial for us to actually think about expanding your partner landscape to also embrace inclusion? And there's some real opportunities there. There's some ways to do it. There's structures you can put in place where you're looking at the organizations that you partner with, and you're determining if you have been building out a diverse landscape of third parties. The more you build it into the very edges of your organization, including those supporting edges, the more effective it's going to be to come up with great innovation and solutions. And another reason we need to do this is because of our customers. So how can we as organizations provide services to a customer base that we don't reflect in our own employees? It's really important that we are in touch with our customers. And one of the challenges I think that a lot of us face in banking is staying in touch with the age difference. We see, you know, all my children are digitally native. None of them has a signature. None of them's ever written a check. And so the diversity that exists in the customer base is something we also need to look at, not just age, but group and demographic. So if you look at your customer base and you compare it to your partners and your employees, do they match? If they don't match, then there's probably work that we can do. And here's something I'll say that sometimes people think is a little controversial, but I would say, as you bring people into your teams, it's important to remember that some people have been systemically held back. And so it may well be that somebody who is a diverse candidate does not have a resume that looks exactly like the resume that you were hoping for. And the reason for that may be nothing to do with their capabilities. It may be because of the systemic biases that do exist in industry today. So my view is, if that person being added to the team has real value, then the fact that it will take them a little longer to come up to speed with the subject matter expertise is okay. Because in the end, a diverse team outperforms a non-diverse team every time. And if you look at each role individually, you might never pick a candidate because there may be a resume that looks like a stronger match. But actually, when you're looking at the whole makeup of your team, another candidate with less of a good match resume is a perfect match to round out the diversity of your team and to make it a really powerful, innovative, and inclusive team. Okay, if you'd like to go to the next slide. Okay, so if we're going to embrace inclusion and we're going to embrace a growth mindset, then what is going to be the outcome? And so here, you know, what you set as a goal is going to drive what you achieve. We all know that. And so if we just talk generally about, well, I'd like to be more inclusive and we'd like to be more innovative, and let's really work on that. That is not going to be something we're going to achieve. So you have to set very specific goals. What is it that you're going to do in order to support inclusion and innovation? Now, on the inclusion side, there's some very specific things you could do. You could, for example, set a diversity metric and monitor that metric and see whether there's anything that that monitoring tells you that requires change. I think there has been for many years, there was a real resistance to looking at diversity metrics because people didn't want to find what was in them. And as soon as you saw it, then you'd have to deal with it. And my reaction to that is yes, see it so that you can deal with it. Now, this is really because of the risk management perspective always, right? People ask me as a risk manager, what keeps you up at night? And I always say, nothing really keeps me up at night. The only thing that can wake me up in the middle of the night in a cold sweat is the idea that there's something I don't know about. Risks that I know about, we absolutely can manage. As soon as you've identified a risk, you can assess that risk, you can monitor that risk, and you can decide, are you going to mitigate it or are you going to accept it? It's if you don't do the risk identification work that the danger lurks. And I think in this space, both for innovation and inclusion, there's a danger in refusing to look. You need to identify where are we right now so that then you can really address where do we want to go. And then you can start to think about how we're going to get there. Now, on the innovation side, you can actually provide a lot of support for that. Now, yes, there's the idea of setting up an innovation lab, sending people off to San Francisco for their free kombucha. That works. It does bring about innovation, but in order for that innovation to come back and be assimilated all the way through the organization, everybody needs to start to embrace innovation. And so there's ways that you can do that in small pockets throughout the company to get the culture embedded. So for example, in the risk management teams that I've run, I've always made a specific effort to include them in the innovation practices of the institution that we're in. So for example, instead of doing a risk and control self-assessment and then doing a business continuity program and then looking at model governance and then doing third-party risk management and having these four separate projects, what I've done in the risk functions in the last few years is turn those into agile sprints because people use those terms like agile sprint. And so you take your risk management work and you turn it into something that has the same language and approach as the innovation that's being explored in the engineering and technology and product areas. And if you want to have a sprint using agile methodology, what you do is you set up a set of stories. For example, do you have a model? Do you have a third party? Do you have internal fraud risks? And those become backstories that get worked through during the process sprint. And you can set time parameters around it, say 2 weeks. And this way you have a risk management function that talks the way that engineering and product talk. And you can do that in every department within the organization. So pockets of innovation tend to not work. In order to be an innovative company, you have to have employees who are all committed to innovation in the processes that they own. Now at Varo, we have the advantage of, you know, we started from scratch. When I joined, there were 167 people. Now we're nearly 1,000. And so as people come in, you can ask, are you innovative? Do you have a growth mindset? Are you inclusive? And bring them into the organization. For larger organizations, you're going to have to get people around the change curve. You're going to have to do that work of making sure they understand why something is being done and then how it can be done. So I think I covered off on some of the main areas I wanted to talk to. The main message I want to bring across is that to have real inclusion and to have real innovation, you have to allow people to be authentic. You have to be willing to change the rules in order to embrace diversity in every room that you're in. And you need to make sure that those people are being heard because innovation is really accelerated by having different perspectives in the room, embracing all of those perspectives. There is nothing more powerful in an organization than a highly performing, diverse team. If you want to find ways to innovate and change your organization or change your product and your services, that is the secret sauce. And if you as an individual want to be able to show up every day and enjoy the work that you're doing, you want to be able to show up with authenticity and bring your whole self to work. And to bring your whole self to work means you need to let others bring their whole self to work as well. And let's embrace that and take advantage of it. Felicia, if you'd like to go to the next slide. Okay, so I'm suggesting we break through a few glass ceilings here. And I'm going to stop now so that we've got some time for conversation and to answer any questions that you might have. I think, Felicia, you had a couple of questions that you wanted me to start with.
Yes, thank you, Philippa. Actually, when you were speaking about haircuts and trousers, that started bringing back memories about, you know, as an African-American woman, when we have our hair done in certain ways, especially with braids or something that could be deemed too ethnic, sometimes we can get pushed back on that. And that's difficult to try to handle, especially in the banking industry, which is a white male dominated, you know, industry. But the first question that I have for you is, how do you truly instill a genuine DEI culture?
I think this is a really good question, because it's really easy to instill a non-genuine DEI culture. All you have to do is start up a bunch of groups and then put them on your website. Done, right? And so I think that in order to have an effective DEI culture, you have to learn to listen to the groups that need to be listened to. And part of this is providing people an opportunity and a platform. So for example, at Varo, I'm on the founding group for the queers and peers group. My youngest child is trans, non-binary, and that gave me an opportunity to work with the LGBTQIA community to say, what do we want to do in this space? Let me be an ally for you. What I find in that space is that it's really important for me to shut up and listen. And I think that's true in a lot of the DEI areas, is it's really easy to come across with this kind of savior mentality where, let me come in and help you be more powerful in your space. No, what we need to do is, let me empower you with a platform for you to be heard, and then step back and let you be heard. And then actually execute on requests. Like, this is something we need to change. All right, let's go ahead and change it. So a small example I will give is that I noticed in our Google meetings that people's names were coming up, not necessarily with their chosen name. It was coming up with the name that they had put into our HR system. So I reached out to HR and to engineering, and I said, is there a way that we could select people's preferred names, which is particularly important for people who are trans, so that they can actually have their preferred name appear on the screen? And the answer was, absolutely, get right on that. So that's a way of saying, here's something I see that you want changed. Let me go and use the power that I have to get that changed for you. And I think we have to do that in every group, right? So in every group that we have, who is the person who has the platform? Are we making sure that they're being clearly heard? If we're in a position of power, are we ensuring that they are being heard and amplifying their voice? And let's make sure that this is real and not a superficial inclusion that we're exploring.
Thank you for that. I think a lot of organizations use ERNs or ERGs, the employee resource networks or employee resource groups, to do that, to gather input from different diverse groups. So I appreciate that. And hope that other organizations are listening who may not have ERNs or ERGs, because that's a way to tap into different groups and get their input. Second question for you. A male-dominated cultural environment is very hard to change. So what do you suggest women do to innovate in this environment to be truly successful?
There's a lot of layers in there. Really? It's like, what is the question? How do we get rid of the male-dominated environment, or how do we personally innovate? So I'll address a few things in there. I think, first of all, there are real allies. There are really true, powerful allies. And where you find them, you should use them. And so what I found very helpful advice along the way, different to the don't apologize all the time kind of advice, was find a sponsor. And I think this is really great advice. So mentors are really helpful, right? Mentors are great. They help you work through particular problems. They help you think about your career choices and so on. A sponsor says good things about you and advocates for you when you are not in the room. And so I would say that one of the key things you can do is just go and ask. And I have done this in the past. I have gone to a powerful male colleague and said, can I ask you to be my sponsor? Please advocate for me when I am not in the room. And you will know quite quickly whether you get an authentic yes or no from somebody. If someone's like, oh, Flor, maybe, then no, go find another one. If they say, how can I do that for you? Tell me how to do it. Then you know you found a sponsor. So I would say go search for one of those. And whether it's a senior woman or a senior man, really good to have a sponsor in the room. And then the other thing I would say is you can actually return authority to yourself sometimes. So sometimes I think what we will tend to do is wait for somebody to give you permission to do something that actually a male colleague would have just gone ahead and done. This is a female tendency. And you can sometimes return authority to yourself. So you say, I'm going to do this thing. And it's not hurting anyone. It's a good thing to do. And I'm going to make it happen. And you will find, to your surprise, that quite often you can affect change by just giving yourself authority to do it. Obviously, you don't want to be breaking the authority of someone else, but there's quite often gaps. There's gaps in the organization where nobody has taken charge of it. Go ahead and take charge of it. Give yourself authority and innovate in that space. I had some really great advice also from Carla Harris. She is a powerful force of nature and Morgan Stanley. And she has this thing called her string of pearls, which is little bits of wisdom, which have stuck with me for years. I was at Morgan Stanley quite a few years ago. One thing she said I really loved, and that was in her performance review at the end of a year, she once got feedback, and she was in a very senior, I think, equity trading desk, only woman there, only woman of color. And somebody said to her, well, the only problem is that you're not really tough enough in this male environment. I don't know that you can hack it. So she thought, well, am I not tough enough? And she decided, no, I actually am tough enough. This is just a bias that someone has. And so for the next year, in every meeting that she was in, she would say, you know me, I'm tough. And then continued in exactly the same way as she had the year before. Didn't change anything else, except added, you know me, I'm tough. And she said at the end of the year, her performance review was, sometimes you're a little too tough. So the other thing I would say is sometimes you can just actually declare something and it becomes real. You could say, you know me, I'm all about the data. And people are going to say, you know, she's always about the data. And so if there's something where you need to be able to show up in a different way. So for example, you could say, you know me, I'm all about driving innovation. And then you're giving yourself permission to drive innovation. And people say, you know, that she drives innovation all the time. And so sometimes just declare it and it becomes real.
I like that. I have to definitely use that. I remember Carla Harris saying that. I heard her speak a couple of occasions, and I tried to use that a couple of times. I don't know if it was that successful, but we shall see. Third question for you. Can you give an example of how an organization can include diversity into a job description or their desire to have a diverse candidate, for an example?
Yeah, it's going to be difficult, I think, to put something in your job description that says, yes, all of you can apply. Because everyone's going to have a little phrase that says we are completely, open and fair in the way that we hire and inclusive. I don't know how much that's going to matter. What I will tell you is that quite a few of the diverse candidates that I've hired recently have said to me, they went to our website and they looked at our management team. And when they saw diversity on the management team, they knew to apply. So I think the reality is you have to demonstrate that you are open and inclusive in order for people to believe it. And then you need to put people on the interview panel to make sure that people are being interviewed by some diverse employees so that they see this is an environment where I would be included because that person is included and is clearly happy here. Now, to start with, that might mean that you have a small group of people who are being asked to interview all the time because you're trying to improve your diversity. That's okay. That's really okay. You can even say to those employees, we want to do better. Can you help us do better? We would love for you to be involved in the interviews so that you can help us do better.
I like that. And I can share some stories about experiences that I've had being on an interview panel, and a female was being interviewed for a position, and you could tell she was very uncomfortable. You know, that first 2 or 3 minutes before the interview starts, where you're doing the small talk. Oh, so how's the weather? How are you doing? How are things going? I felt like she was warming up a little bit. And a few times she even looked at me and kind of smiled like, ooh, I'm glad you're here. So that is very interesting that you could see that and almost see her get a little bit more comfortable in her body language. And I think people need to be real mindful of that when they're interviewing, and they do desire to see different types of candidates. You have to represent that as well. So thank you for coming. Fourth question for you. What advice do you have for someone that is having difficulty attracting?
Well, you're in a bit of a catch-22. To my point before, if you don't have any, you can't demonstrate that you have any. And so that becomes a problem. But there are organizations you can go to who will help you. Right? There are organizations, for example, that look specifically at hiring African-American candidates, who look specifically at hiring people in the Latinx community, and they will connect you with candidates. And I don't have to hand the name of all those candidates, but of all those groups, but I'm sure we could source it for people afterwards. And I have found them to be quite effective. I will say I haven't found them to be completely effective. That I've been occasionally a bit disappointed that I'm not getting as many candidates as I want to get through that process. We've had to go out and do it ourselves. One of the things that has been a very helpful to me at Varo is when we opened up the North Carolina office. As soon as we opened up the North Carolina office, it opened up opportunities for us to tap into a whole work market that was much more diverse than the ones that we had. And so if where you're looking to hire people, you're not finding the candidates you need, go look somewhere else. If you have an approach where everybody has to come into the office and the office is in an area that has no diversity, you're not going to be successful in finding diverse candidates. You have to go find them. And especially right now, I mean, people have had these huge epiphanies around life in the last 18 months, which is, this is not worth it. And so if you want to have somebody want to come and work for you, you need to reach out to them where they are, which might mean you need to support more remote permanent working. If the community that you want to tap into is not where you are, you have to go to where it is. And it's worth it. It's really worth it, because if you bring that diversity into your company, you will be more innovative and you will be demonstrating to your customers and to your other employees that you are inclusive and that you value everybody who's coming to the table. So it's worth making changes if you need to make changes.
Thank you for that. And when you think about looking for female candidates, or you're looking for a particular candidate based on gender, It's really interesting to note that some executive search firms, I think, are paying more attention to the types of candidates that they're pulling, whether they're using LinkedIn or whether they're just using, you know, word of mouth or relationships that they have built. But it's important for those of you who are out there using LinkedIn, if you're trying to get attention, to have photos on your LinkedIn page. Because if someone is looking for a person of color or a person who happens to identify as female or whatever, I think it's important to show who you are, or to at least talk about who you are, so that they can at least know where to point their attention.
Well, and this, I would say, Felicia, is a good sign of how things have improved, because certainly studies done 10 years ago showed that there was an unconscious bias in the first step of recruiting based on somebody's name, if it gave an indication of their gender or race, which is a terrible situation. Now I think we're kind of in the opposite situation where people really are eager to fix what has been broken for so long and want to find those communities to hire from. So I think you're right, Felicia, actually be overt in who you are and what you bring to the team.
Yes, thank you for that. And to add a plug for Bank on Women Incorporated, for organizations who are looking to fill board positions, they have a service that they provide where they find individuals who are qualified and sort of vet them, give them information and resources, and are building a database for qualified females who are ready and able to fill board seats. So there are organizations out there who are serving that purpose too for boards who are seeking individuals, not just C-suites, but also for, you know, board positions, because I know that's both excellent. Are very different. Okay, another question for you. Can you share advice for planning management succession to ensure diversity?
Yes, such a timely topic for me, because I've now been in my role for 2.5 years and I'm thinking, oh, I need to make sure there's succession. And so I've been looking across the organization, and my leadership team know that I'm thinking this way, is where is the succession plan? And does that succession plan include all the diversity that we've been so careful to build? So I think you do need to look across all of the plus ones and see in that layer, do we also have the diverse representation that we want? And if we don't, how are we going to get it? Is it that there's somebody there who you think could be a great candidate, but in 5 years, but maybe 5 years is too long. So what can you do to expedite that 5 years down to one? How can you provide them with coaching, with mentoring, with sponsorship, with opportunities to stretch themselves, take on more responsibility so that they are actually being groomed for that succession? I think it has to be a very thoughtful process and we need to pay a lot of attention to it. So it's a great topic. And it's something that people tend to put on the back burner because you're so busy doing your job. The idea of thinking about someone else doing your job is kind of like, I don't have time for that. I've just got to get my work done. But you do need to be thinking about that, because I certainly am not going to stay in my job for the next 20 years. I've just put that out there right now in case anyone thinks I am. And so I would like to find what is the right succession plan. I think in the plus ones that I have in my organization, I have great diversity, which gives us a lot of opportunities for advancement. The other thing I think in smaller institutions, so in community banks, for example, that are more like the size of Varo, you do also need to find lateral moves for people, because there might not be enough space for somebody to move up. So while they might be a great successor candidate, they've actually got nowhere to go to build those skills until you leave. And so how are you going to give them that opportunity, which means you might need to give them lateral moves to help them move up and be ready.
Great points, thank you. And Ruby put something in the chat, Ruby Tomstead, any comments on what is being called the Great Resignation currently taking place? What would you say to women in this environment?
Yes, well, what's heartbreaking about the Great Resignation is the women. Right? Women are leaving the workforce in droves, and it's going to change the statistics, I think, very negatively in the next few years. So first of all, I would say, if you are part of the Great Resignation, first of all, I would say, don't feel bad about it. You get to make the choices you want to make. You will need to stay home and homeschool your kids and look after life. That's fine. You're allowed to make whatever choices you want to make. So first of all, I don't want to put guilt on people for making choices that are not career focused. It's absolutely fine. The other thing I'd say is you can always come back. Okay? A decision that you make for the next 5 years is not your decision for life. It's not. It's a decision for now. And so do what you need to do. What I will also say is for those of us who are looking to hire people and are dealing with the other end of the Great Resignation, is what are we doing to really think about the change in expectation around work-life balance and the ability to align your personal values with your corporate values of the place that you work? And I think it's easy for people in my generation to look at the next couple of generations, millennial, Gen X, Gen Z, and say they don't have the same book ethos that we have. And the answer is no, they don't. God bless them. What were we thinking? Working 18 hours a day and all weekend for a company that we maybe didn't feel passionate about. No, they don't want to do that. And why should they? So I think we have to think about how do we provide a work environment that is truly appealing to people who they want to work. Everyone loves to work. They do. People really enjoy having a great job. If you met somebody who says, I love my job, it's the best thing, I'm so lucky to have it, you know, passion around your work is a real thing. So I would say if you're part of the Great Resignation and you're deciding to leave, that's fine. You do what you need to do. If you're trying to keep hold of people and you're trying to attract people, look at the choices people are making and see what changes you can make. Could you make it so that roles actually don't have fixed hours? Could you make it so that there's unlimited vacation because you trust people to get work done? Could you make it so that there was longer maternity leave for people who want to go and come back? What could you do that would support people being able to come back and work really well with great productivity in your organization and challenge the norms? And coming from Europe, you know, sometimes I kind of got used to America. And I was in Europe this summer and my cousin was telling me how she worked more than 37 and a half hours last week. And so she got a note from her boss that she had to stop logging in. I'm like, wow, I've been in America a long time because that seems amazing to me. And this was really exactly her experience. When I spoke to other people in England, they were like, yeah, of course, that's normal. So we need to really think if we want to hold people, what is the work environment we want them to work in?
Yes, thank you so much, Philippa. And that wraps up this session for today. Thank you so much for being with us and for your insightful comments. We really appreciated them. And Nancy, to you too, thank you for being with us today. We're going to take a brief break and ask that everyone return at exactly 2:10 Eastern Time for our engaging panel discussion entitled, This is How We Do It, Past and Present. Bank directors will share their stories. No need to exit or leave the Zoom platform. We'll see you back here in about 10 minutes. Thank you. Hi, Chris. Hi, Jim.
Is that Felicia?
Yes, it is. How are
you? How are you?
Good, good.
Hello, Felicia.
Hi, Sherilyn.
Hi, Felicia.
Nice to see you.
Nice to see you, too. Sorry about all the thrashing around this morning, but we figured
No problem at all. No problem at all. Is everybody okay? You need anything? Any questions?
I think we're good. Hello, Sherilyn. Hello, Chris.
Hello, Jim. Yeah, I'm good on the questions. I just need the answers, if you could give them.
Okay.
We've got a good group. I meant to announce it, but we started running over. There are 410 registered participants for this year's Women in Banking Symposium, or what we're calling Banking Symposium for short. Of the 410 registered, about 32% are C-suite and board members, and about 68% are in a management position or deemed an individual contributor. So that's just an FYI to give you an idea of who could be, you know, on the call today for your audience.
Great. Now, Felicia, how many years has this been? Is this year three?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Okay.
Yeah, the first year was in person. Obviously, it was in 2019, and it was held in Richmond, Virginia, in our facility. So we were limited in how many people could participate. And then last year, due to COVID, we went virtual, and that's when the numbers just kind of blew out of the water, about 400 or so, just like this year.
Yeah, it's given a lot of people kind of a pause of how you do these events going down the road. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It could be kind of a hybrid of a little of both.
Yes, definitely. Good point.
Link, Jim, did you send out the updated questions to all the panelists?
Did you?
Yes.
You should have received them from Jessica. I think she.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay.
There's updated questions.
Well, I reviewed the previous one we had against the updated. They look the same. I might have missed something.
That's what I was going to say. I don't know if they changed much.
Yeah, I didn't see any changes because I panicked too.
Well, I didn't even see them, so I'm just panicking now.
I think that came in the email, Sherilyn, that had your link.
So maybe I missed that whole thing.
It was an attachment. It had the questions and then the agenda for the day from Jessica King.
And it came out maybe hour and a half ago, hour and 15 minutes.
Okay. But if they're the same, then I won't worry about it.
I think you'll be fine. Yeah, I think the questions really are there just to kind of give you a general idea of what people may be thinking about and interested in. But if we get new ones in the chat or in the Q&A box, we'll try to filter them through Courtney Bailey. And Jim, if you need more questions or you desire more questions or, you know, you let me know how you want to handle that.
Well, tell me if we do get a question in the chat, how would they communicate it to me?
Well, I will have them because Courtney is kind of pulling it all together because you can't, sometimes you tell people to put them in the Q&A and then they throw them in the chat. So she's pulling them all together from the chat and the Q&A and anything that has been resubmitted as well. And some people are even emailing questions to her directly. So she's just gathering all of that and putting it in one place because I think what we're also trying to do is if for some odd reason we can't get to certain questions, we're going to try to at least answer them and get back to those people who asked the questions.
Felicia, Courtney.
You got it.
Hey, I'm going to highlight those in the chat box. And I just want to make a reminder that this feed is live still.
Oh, sorry.
So not that there's anything wrong with that. I just wanted to make you all aware.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Is this being recorded as well?
It is, I think.
And now there's going to be dead silence.
No more sausage making.
All right, we got 3 minutes. And I'll see you guys back in a couple minutes. Okay, and welcome back. We're going to move into our panel discussion for this afternoon. This is how we do it. Past and present bank directors will share their stories. To allow ample time to hear from our panel, we ask that you send your questions to Courtney Bailey at the Richmond Fed. You can see the chat or also use the Q&A box. We'll be sure to get those answered for you. Moderating our panel today is Jim Sills. Jim is the president and CEO of M&F Bank, the second oldest African-American bank in the nation. Jim's background includes a unique combination of executive management experience within large-scale banking operations, community banks, and government organizations. He has over 30 years of banking and technology management experience. Jim is passionate about community banking and is very active in industry and community organizations. He serves as chairman of the North Carolina Bankers Association, chairman of the Independent Community Bankers of America Minority Banking Council, and is a member of the Richmond Fed Board of Directors, among many other things. Welcome, Jim. On our panel today, we have Mary Ann Scully. Mary Ann is the CEO of Howard Bank, Maryland's third largest locally headquartered bank. She's also chairperson of its board of directors and has more than 40 years of varied executive experiences in the Maryland marketplace. Prior to Howard, Mary Ann was employed by AllFirst Bank for 30 years. Mary Ann is a trustee of the Enoch Pratt Library, Loyola University of Maryland, Mount St. Joseph College High School, the Community Foundation of Howard County Real Estate Board, the Inner Arbor Trust, and serves as vice chair of the Greater Baltimore Committee. Mary Ann is a past member of the Richmond Fed Board of Directors and was inducted into the Business and Civic Hall of Fame by the Baltimore Sun in 2020, among many other industry and community honors. Welcome, Mary Ann. Chris St. Martin is the bank program director for CBiz and coordinates the marketing of the 30 plus CBiz service offerings to financial institutions. Chris's personal practice specialty is board risk and cyber risk and the placing of insurance protections. Chris served for over 20 years in the banking industry and was most recently a founder and CEO of a community bank. Last year, Chris was the recipient of the Bank on Women's Inaugural Champions Award and the CBiz Women's Advantage Champions Award as well. Welcome, Chris. And last but not least, we have Sherilyn Anderson, who is the CFO of Betacom, a nationwide constructor of cell infrastructure and an innovator in the new private wireless network space. Sherilyn is a strategy and operations executive with deep experience driving growth, change, and improved financial performance for mid-sized and Fortune 500 companies in the telecommunications, retail, and financial services sectors. Prior to Betacom, Sherilyn was CFO of Glassy Baby, a Seattle-based producer and nationwide retailer of hand-blown glass votives and glassware. She has also enjoyed a 20-year investment banking career and has had executive roles with Wells Fargo Securities and Goldman Sachs, for an example. Sherilyn is a member of the boards of directors for First Northwest Bancorp and First Federal Savings and Loan Association and the Pacific Science Center, among other notable roles. Welcome, Sherilyn. Thank you all for being here. And Jim, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Felicia. Good afternoon and welcome, everyone. Again, my name is Jim Sills, and I'm going to serve as your moderator today. It's been a wonderful virtual conference, and I'm excited to be here today because they have saved the best panel for last. We have a very diverse C-suite level audience listening in today, and I hope we can influence the thinking in the financial services industry to improve gender diversity at all levels. Before we get started, I have some interesting stats related to gender diversity in our industry from Bank on Women Incorporated. I think we all know that companies are trying to have equal representation at the leadership level. However, women make up 20% of the C-suite roles, and for women of color, it's only 4%. Boards had the opportunity to have a, when you're on a board, you have the opportunity to have a seat at the table to contribute to the strategy and priorities of a company. But as it relates to women serving on bank boards, a couple of interesting statistics. The top 20 banks, women make up 29% of their board composition. On community banks, women make up only 16% of the board composition. And this really surprised me. 18% of all community banks do not have any women on their boards at all. And then lastly, you know, there's a lot of data out in the marketplace. You know, when you have diversity in your company, you're more likely to outperform your competition in terms of profitability. So these stats really opened up my eyes. We have a long way to go. I look forward to learning from our distinguished panelists about the strategies and best practices to help women advance in the financial services industry. So we're going to kick it off, and I'm going to ask this question of everybody, but I'm going to start with Cheryl Lynn. What innovative approaches, ideas have you seen that integrate women into leadership roles?
Great question. Thanks, Jim. And the stats are a little troubling. And I would point out that I am on the board of First Federal, which is a community bank. So, and we can talk a little bit later about how, you know, what things I think can be done to specifically address that. I think three things that I'd like to mention. One is mentorship, but maybe put in a slightly different context, which is maybe another way to put it is give somebody a challenge, but give them help. So it's not just encouraging somebody to progress along the normal order of things, but give them a challenge, give them something that's hard to do, but then make sure you're standing with them to help them. That's happened in my career, and we can talk about that later. I think the big thing, probably the biggest thing, is going outside your network. So it's very easy to tap into our friends and people that we know, people we socialize with, so on and so forth. But we really have to extend ourselves to go outside of our own networks. And then we have to have the discipline once people come into our organizations to treat them, to include them, just like the people that we know better. So, you know, maybe if your organization already has people that you know well in it, and this is somebody that you don't know well, you're going to have to work hard to include them. And then I think another thing is you really have to commit to having more than one person of color, more than one woman on your board or in a leadership role. It may not happen instantaneously, but you have to make that commitment that it's going to happen in a reasonable amount of time, 6 to 12 months, to make that person feel comfortable and successful.
Okay, great. Thank you, Cheryl Lynn. I'm going to turn it over to Mary Ann.
You're on mute, Mary Ann.
I don't know that I'd want to start with innovative, because not unlike what Cheryl Lynn said, I think that it starts with more of a basic belt and braces approach, that this is something that the board has a commitment to. It has to be very intentional. You talked about your surprise, Jim, at some of the community bank statistics and how some community banks have no representatives, even though so many of us work in communities where, just from a stakeholder representation standpoint, you would want to have that diversity. Not to mention the fact that at the end of the day, what diversity and inclusion is all about is having diverse perspectives. Our industry isn't an easy industry. The margins get tighter and tighter, it seems, every quarter. And to have any sort of diverse perspective provides you with a better chance of success. So the commitment starts with representing your stakeholders. It then moves to a basic strategic focus on how do we get more diverse opinions. But I know in my past, as I've talked to some of my community bank president colleagues, and haven't necessarily wanted to attack them, but have simply asked the question, why do you have no women on your board? Or why do you have no women in your C-suite? Tell me what you think is going on here. I've had other community bank presidents tell me that they don't know any women. Reminds us all of a presidential candidate 10 years ago, maybe, with his binders of women. And so what I've said to them when they say, how do you do it, is it starts with being intentional. It starts with this being part of the strategy. And therefore, to me, that's even more important than being innovative, because you want it to be something basic. You want it to be a core purpose of your company for any number of reasons. And that intentionality has allowed us to have not as high a percentage, but 3 of our 13 directors are women, 2 are of color, and we developed a matrix. Again, nothing rocket science about this. We developed a matrix of what characteristics we thought we needed on our board to represent our stakeholders, to represent the competencies that we needed in a tough industry. And as you're filling in that matrix, you will be able to more intentionally make sure you've got those diverse perspectives.
Thank you, Marianne. I have a follow-up question for you before we turn it over to Chris. You know, that skills matrix, and all banks and major corporate companies have that kind of matrix, but a lot of those skills are kind of male dominated. Are there any skills that you have on your matrix that may be different than a typical corporation that has that all the male-dominated skills listed on their matrix?
Well, I hope it's not necessarily that different, but I think that all of us, no matter what business we're in, are in people businesses. You know, I remember when I, in my very first job as a traveling banker, handled the Midwest, so called on a lot of manufacturing companies. But I remember coming back and telling my colleagues that at the end of the day, it was people that made decisions on banking matters, people, not companies. And so if we're all in the talent acquisition game, we do know that for better or for worse, women often get slotted into HR positions. And so talent acquisition, talent development is a competency, a skill set that we're looking for that allows us to attract more women. Entrepreneurship is one that we have on our matrix level, because we're mostly a small and medium-sized business bank. And you do find many, many women who are in the ranks of entrepreneurs. So yes, I think without necessarily leading the witness, we do have certain core competencies that probably play at least as well, if not more, to women. But we all know that there are also great women financial officers, great women chief accounting officers. You just have to have that broader perspective, as Sherilyn said, and not just keep fishing in the same pond that you've always fished in.
Very good. Chris, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Great. And yeah, and I would agree wholeheartedly with everything Marianne and Sherilyn had said. And then I would add leadership and getting their buy-in is a really a critical factor. And it kind of all starts there before you can get all the emphasis behind all of these good things. And you know, and I started working with Bank on Women because Terry Spiro, CEO of Cecil Bank in Maryland, was a customer of mine, and we worked together for many years. And Bank on Women, I really, really like what they do, because they focus on the business case. And our first event that we kind of partnered on together was they kept providing me, and they being Bank on Women, and we were going to sponsor and invite and organize the group. The business case for it. And that to me was a little bit of a new concept. And I like the idea of people sharing their personal stories, which I think there's a really good approach for. But after working with them for a number of years here, I've kind of changed how I look at it. I see that there's kind of 3 approaches to accelerating change, kind of big picture things. One, you can regulate and legally force people to change their boards. Second, you can appeal to their moral fairness argument. And then 3, you can present the business case. And I've really changed my thinking on that, because each one of these, the first 2 have some problems with. One, regulation, people don't like to be forced to do things, and that can develop cynicism and pushback. Appealing to a moral fairness argument, there's definitely some merit there, but we all have our our own morals. We all have our own causes, and this may not be in my top five for a certain board member, but the business case is in every board member's top five. So every board member is going to be focused on having a good quality business that's very profitable. And that needs to be part of their function, because if there's no, as one of the people I used to work for with used to say, no profit, no, there is no mission. So whether your mission is growing the business and making money, or giving to local charities, or having a family legacy, you've got to be profitable. And the business case that the Bank on Women make in some of their documents is very, very, very powerful. And I think that if I was going to start within a bank today, I would start there and try to really get people thinking about this topic and what it can do to their business.
And before you move on and go around the table again, tell us what you think and what you've experienced in terms of the best way to build a diverse board.
Myself?
No, Jim.
Oh, for Jim. Oh, I'm okay.
Thank you,
so he doesn't
Mary
get to just ask all the questions. He gets
yeah. Go ahead. Put Jim on the spot.
Put me on the spot. You know, great question. You know, again, I think we have to, you know, as I stated earlier, a lot of boards rely on that board matrix, skills matrix. And I think we need to throw it out the window. Secondarily, I think we need to expand the networks that we actually try to tap into to attract women to our various banks and corporations. A lot of times it's the good old boy network, you know, in terms of the country club and the golf buddies and, you know, football, you know, alumni of various schools. And they tend to just, you know, bring into a corporate board the same people that they interact with all the time. And so I think we need to do a better job of making people aware of these opportunities in people of color, but also women. I think a lot of times these opportunities, it's only shared with a small number of people out in the community. So that would be some of my thoughts on that topic. Yeah, I wanted to go back to something Chris said about kind of disclosure. And I think all of you know that NASDAQ has a new disclosure that they're about to implement, where they want to kind of see, you know, gender and racial diversity of some of the NASDAQ related companies. It's my understanding that the FDIC is going to be asking a very similar question about bank boards. So do you think that'll accelerate the number of women and also the racial diversity of boards a lot faster than what has happened in the last, say, 20 years or so? And I'll start with the Sherilyn.
Yeah, it's a great question, Jim. I think so. I also think, I know we're looking very hard at shareholder, you know, the pressure from shareholders to make changes in our organization. And, you know, while I think some of that, the ESG frameworks and the ESG impetus is still quite, it's not very universal. There's not universal acceptance of what those criteria are. I think that is something maybe even more than these disclosure requirements that's pushing us to improve the diversity inside the bank staff, as well as board and C-suite. So I do think all that attention from whatever the source, shining the light on our activities and our attempts to be more diverse is definitely making a difference.
Marianne, any comments or Chris on that?
Yeah, I would agree with Sherilyn. I mean, I will go on record as saying that I've not historically been a huge advocate of quota systems, because I think that they sometimes diminish the value that's associated with a woman or a minority on a board, and they're viewed as just filling a quota. But if you think about where we are today, the statistics that we just talked about in terms of the percentage of women directors, the large company percentages versus the community banks, the banks that have no women directors, There needs to be some sort of a catalyst that at least creates awareness. Because if you can't do it from a business case perspective, as Chris said, intuitively, you should be able to. If you don't acknowledge the importance of having those different perspectives to help you in a very tough industry, then there needs to be some sort of external catalyst. And I think that to some extent, the way NASDAQ has done it is around awareness. I mean, it's not initially a penalty system. It's a question, do you have this? And understand that if you don't, then at some point in time, this could be a mark against you. But we clearly are at a point, a salient trajectory change in our country where we need to raise that awareness. And I think that the NASDAQ initiative will do as much as anything. I know that the SEC is also looking at things in addition to the FDIC.
Just to kind of follow up on that, Marianne, I think that the old saying that change is really hard and people only change when not changing is worse. Right. So in a sense, that's what's happening here, right, is that spotlight and that impetus, making it harder, making it more uncomfortable not to change may help some people get over that hump to a change that needs to be made.
Okay, we're gonna go to our next question, and this question is gonna be, it's for all of you. It's gonna be directed to Chris first. How do you work to ensure your network represents the communities you serve? Do you have an example where leveraging that network increased your organization's gender diversity? So Chris, we're gonna start with you.
Yeah, thank you. So at our company, CBiz, we have an internal group that's going on, I think about 15 years, and it's called CBiz Women's Advantage. And it is a really great and powerful group. And again, I just really stress senior management support, because it is very much part of senior management's strategic plan. And so we go to the point of actually tracking revenue on any new piece of business within CBiz, whether or not that we track three things, because we invest a lot of time and energy into it. One is LinkedIn, one is Salesforce, and one is CBiz Women Advantage. So all of our proposals from all of our different business lines include information on what CBiz Women Advantage is and how we can partner with that group. So as examples of that, we just had one yesterday, a quarterly speaker. We feature successful women. The topic was uncovering talent and creating a culture of inclusion. And just the quarterly speakers puts us in contact with a lot of great women leaders and from making contact in their businesses, and provides opportunities to invite existing and new networks and contacts to attend. So it's a great format for spreading the word and making new contacts. CBiz Women Advantage have also been a big supporter with my work with Bank on Women. And so they've actively provided sponsorships for different events and allowed for a lot of time from our various people to be at different association meetings and panel discussions. So, you know, some of the results of that, one of our people that has been recent in my team in Minneapolis, and I would call her a rising star in my group, has said many times to me that one of the reasons she came to CBiz was our CWA program, and how her perception from the outside is that we have more opportunities, better mentorships, and so on with women. And she's now on our internal CWA board and is just a fantastic add to our team. And there's many of those type of examples along the way with our own program.
Okay, thanks, Chris. Sherilyn, will you take that question on too?
Sure. So, you know, I was reflecting on this concept of network, whether it's our personal networks or kind of our company networks. And I think one of the big advantages of community banks is presumably they know their community really well. So I think there are two, before I joined my bank board, before I joined the First Fed board, there were already two other women on the board, and they were both very invested and engaged in the community that First Federal serves. So I think if you have your head up and looking around you, you will see that there are women who are very engaged, either in a professional capacity or very engaged in building their communities. And so I think your earlier question about what do you do about, or I think actually it's Marianne who raised the question of the board matrix. I think that's another characteristic that could be added to a board matrix is community engagement, community involvement, because there are many women who are accomplished, well-educated, but maybe have made the choice instead to support their communities. So to be on community boards, to do that kind of work. So I think that's another avenue to look at whether there are people, maybe they don't have every qualification or capability that are needed, but again, with mentorship or challenge, with support, they could grow into really great board members for a bank.
Okay, great. Marianne?
Yeah, I'll pick up on something that Sherilyn said. I mean, I think for most community bankers, their networks are pretty broad because if you're doing your good job as a community bank CEO, you're reaching out into different segments of your community. So nothing that we've done to make sure that we have that pool of potentially ready board candidates has been forced. It's been part of our normal networking activities. Now, we happen to operate in a number of counties in the state of Maryland. One of them is Baltimore City, which is a majority minority city. We operate in others like Howard County, which are close to being majority minority. So admittedly, maybe that sort of marketing and networking that just naturally leads to more diverse contacts is something that we benefit from that others would not. But I think the whole idea of networking is to build new connections and to then use those connections to build other connections. It's a network, it's a lattice. And we've found that to be incredibly helpful. I would also acknowledge that I think having a female CEO perhaps makes it more natural. You attract those questions around diversity. Having not only one of our board members, but our governance chair being a woman and a woman of color, again, means that you are naturally attracting that perspective. I mean, you're a little bit like a walking billboard for why a company wants to have this diversity of perspectives.
Marianne, that was a great answer. And if you could just say it one more time, that we need to put more women in the role of serving as the chairperson of the nomination and governance committees of various corporations, and you'll see that percentage actually.
You absolutely will. I mean, we're advantaged in that we have a board chair and a governance chair who are both representing diverse communities, and that makes it all certainly very much strategic and very much a frequent source of conversation. And if we're both doing our job, which I think both of us have, we're demonstrating to people every single board meeting at a minimum, the value of having those different perspectives, the walking billboards.
Excellent. All right, I'm gonna ask a few one-off questions for each person individually. So the first question is for Sherilyn. As a newer board member, how has your experience been in your role? What attracted you to board service for the financial service organizations?
Yeah, great question. So I am a new board member. I've been on my board now for just a year. So it's been great. It's really been fantastic. I've loved it. I've felt very appreciated and rewarded by my board. I think I'm not the first woman on the board, but the board was extremely intentional. That's a word that Marianne used, starting back before the bank went public 7 or 8 years ago, to increase the number of women on the board and also to increase the geographic reach of the bank. And that's where I think it has been more tricky, because while the bank was very embedded in its community, it wasn't very didn't have a very wide network beyond the Olympic Peninsula, where the bank is headquartered. So it was a very concerted effort to professionalize the board, to extend the reach of the board, to gain greater skill on the board. And so that's actually how I came to the board. The question about how I decided to pursue board service. So I was in the financial services industry for much of my career, which pretty much precluded board service on a financial services company. But as I gained more experience and had more and more strategic roles in my career, I started to realize that was one of the things that I really enjoyed. And of course, I'd served on nonprofit boards, which I think was a great training ground for me to develop those types of board leadership skills, which are different than executive leadership skills. So I just really have gravitated toward wanting to serve in that capacity. And it's actually a program in Seattle. Some other communities may have these as well, called Onboarding Women. So it was founded by a group of four companies, a law firm, a search firm, a venture capital firm, and accounting firm, who recognized some of these statistics that you've cited, Jim, and thinking, oh, you know, we're in progressive Seattle, we must be doing better than that. And the answer was actually no. It was worse than the national stats. So this group of companies banded together and said, we really need to do something about this. So they created this program, which the purpose of it is training for board service and then actively helping women gain board seats. So it's a fantastic thing. I think it's something that a community can do. There's a similar program that the University of Washington does as well. So I think those kinds of programs are certainly beneficial to me, not only the training, but the networking. Were fantastic for me. And so that really helped me realize my goal of corporate board service.
Great answer. It's very interesting. We have the East Coast, the Midwest, and the far West Coast on this
West Coast.
And I'm down south in North Carolina.
I bet somebody planned that, Jim. Right. It's a well-planned conference. So.
Geographic diversity.
Yeah, geographic diversity. There you go. This question is for Mary Ann, and Mary Ann, you've kind of touched on this, but I'm going to ask it anyway. Given both your long history of founding and growing Howard Bank as the president and as chairman, what would you say are the keys to a successful, effective, and diverse board?
Well, I have touched on a number of them, but let's start with the fact that I think, like so many other things, you know, leadership starts from the front. And so it clearly needs to be something that your board and your teammates understand is a priority. I think also something that comes naturally to good community bankers is anticipating what some of the objections might be, understanding what the fears and the concerns are, Geraldine's observation about change. And I do know that on boards, especially public company boards, especially boards of highly regulated companies, that it's very legitimately important to board members to feel trust, to feel trust with one another, that, you know, they're not going to wake up someday and find out that, you know, there's a knife in their back or a disclosure that was made that shouldn't have been made. But I think if you build a culture on a board that's both receptive to change, but also is very focused on collegiality. And we've been advantaged not only from the fact that we've got a woman chair, we've got women on our board, and have always had women on our board. We've rotated different women through the board over the years. So we've managed to, you know, acquire, retain, and at some points replace. But we've also managed through acquisitions that we've done to create a culture where people are receptive to bringing new blood onto the board and then working very hard to integrate that new blood so that trust doesn't necessarily need to precede a relationship, but it certainly needs to occur in the middle of a relationship. So I acknowledge, you know, that objection that some people make or the fear that some people have. Well, I need to know this person to trust them. you don't necessarily need to know them in advance to trust them, but you need to set up a process that can engender that kind of trust once they're already on the board. So that, for me, that acknowledgement of the other side, if you will, and the objections and trying to anticipate those and deal with them up front was very helpful. And then I think the third thing is to weave all of this, and I talked about in the very beginning, this idea of diverse perspectives make a company stronger. It's the business case that Bank on Women makes. It makes a company stronger. You can prove that. So if you emphasize that this isn't a standalone strategy, this is a strategy that's consistent with your other strategies, revenue growth so that you're dealing with other stakeholders, expense savings so that you can trust one another to honestly talk about where you think you might be heavy or you might be fat or you might be able to do something digitally rather than personally. All of those things tie together with a diverse perspective. It's not standalone.
Right. Great, great answer. Thank you. We're going to shift gears here a little bit. We're going to spend some time now discussing your advocacy experiences, and we're going to start with Chris. So Chris, this question is for you. Given your extensive experience in community banking, will you share an experience that increased your awareness/consciousness that led you to become an advocate for gender diversity?
For starters, I have a lot of in-house awareness because my wife, Kathleen, of 30 years is a business owner in an extremely male-dominated industry, which is the jewelry business. And if you think banking is male-dominated, you should take a look at that industry sometime. So we've had many shared experiences and conversations over the years. Being a banker for 20 plus years, at one time I had 21 direct reports. They were all women, so we've had lots of conversation. And then more recently, in my dealing with Bank on Women and some of the events we had, the first one that we did, Terry Spiro asked me if I could put a few people on the phone from the Midwest. This might have been 3 years ago. And so they could share the story of Bank on Women and maybe develop some people that have some interest in it. And I remember thinking at that time of, I know there's interest in that topic, but I hope I can get 10 people on the phone there. So I remember I sent out an email to about 10 people. As I recall, it was 8 women and 2 men that I thought might have some strong interest in this topic. And by them forwarding on the invite to other people, they were middle management executives, CEOs of banks in the Midwest, we had 55 people on the phone in 7 days. And that was a bit of an eye opener as far as the passion and the importance of the issue with bankers, and that's my customer base. And so also, with our own culture at CBiz, as I had shared a little bit, it's very, very important. So kind of all those things have contributed to me being an advocate in the industry, as well as all my work with both those organizations, CWA and CBiz and Bank on Women.
Chris, I have a follow-up question for you.
Yeah.
Do you have any advice for someone who wants to be an ally but is unsure of how to begin?
Yeah, and we mentioned Bank on Women several times, and I think that's just a phenomenal organization to just give a call or send an email to either Jennifer Doherty, Terry, Lori, any number of the people there. They're just phenomenal to deal with. They'll spend some time with you. So whether you wanted maybe to learn more and understand the facts, or you might want to be on an advisory board for them in different regions, however you might want to get more information or participate, I think that would be a phenomenal way to do it. And you can always contact me too. I'd be happy to put you in touch with the right person.
Okay, great. Ladies, any comments on that second half of that question? Do you have any advice for someone that wants to be an ally but is unsure of how to begin?
I'll take that, Jim. Okay. I think you just begin. I think you just begin. It's like any other item. You make it an action item, not a discussion item, and you just begin. And, you know, I've been blessed with male advocates. So, you know, it allows me to perhaps begin or continue my efforts as an advocate because I've seen other people and I've seen men do it for me.
Yeah, I would agree with that, that I think just beginning. So if you are a manager, whatever level you are, you don't have to be the CEO or the COO or the CFO, looking or encouraging people in your organization at whatever level they are to look around their team and identify people with capability. And as I said at the very beginning, encourage them, give them a challenge and give them support and encourage them to grow. So I think it can be, doesn't have to be a big grand plan to start with, just starting with what you've got, starting with the people you have, and encouraging and accelerating their development is a great way to be an advocate.
Hey, this next question, go ahead.
Jim, I would just add to that. I'd agree with all that. It reminds me of the old Nike slogan, just do it. And, you know, a lot of companies I think reacted after the George Floyd, which was right down the block from our office, murder a couple of years ago, and put out a lot of kind of stuff there. The sincerity, sometimes you might have questioned, but you know, if you may not have the perfect plan, and in fact, maybe some action is better than a perfect plan, but just start some of these things that we've talked about, just start doing it. And even if it's just part of 10 things, pick two or three that you can do depending on your size, your organization, and just try to start making some progress.
Okay. This question is a great question as a follow-up to your answers, Marianne and Sherilyn, and it's directed to the two of you. Do you have a story to share that demonstrates a male ally advocating for your development over your career?
I certainly do, and maybe that's why I'm focused on that, is remembering that I've been in male-dominated industries, first as an industrial engineer in the aerospace industry, and then more recently in financial services. Yes, absolutely. I think one story, back when I was a junior investment banker, we were awarded we were hired by the city of Los Angeles to do a series of very complex and very high profile transactions to refinance and expand the Los Angeles Convention Center to what it looks like today. And I was on that team, and the head of our services, or I guess our quant group, came to me and said, okay, I want you're gonna run the numbers. You're gonna do all the financial analysis for this series of transactions. And he must have seen that I looked like I was gonna faint or run the other way or something. And I said, you know, I don't know, I'm not ready. And he said, yes, you are. I will be right here. I will be helping you, but you are ready and you're gonna do this. And he was right. So it was that the push plus the encouragement and being that right there to help me through it. And that's happened several times in my career. So I wouldn't be where I was without somebody pushing me along, leading me along, but providing help, not just saying you're going to do it all by yourself, but you're going to do it and I'll be here to help you.
Okay, great. Marianne?
Yes, I like Sherilyn, I've had probably a number of examples of these. And I've been in the business for a long time, as the introduction alluded to. And so when I started in banking in the 70s, you know, that was a good 10 years after certain first pieces of legislation had been passed that allowed a very idealistic and naive young college graduate to assume that everything was now possible for women. It was just going to happen. The doors were going to be open. And I always tell people that I very quickly realized that while everything might be possible, very little of it was probable at that point in time. And so I intuitively sought out the advocates. I was blessed with a president of the first company that I worked for, who, while he hadn't necessarily had a lot of experience in promoting women into certain positions, I might have often been that first woman. He had daughters, And I very early gravitated to senior men in the organization that had daughters, because I knew that these were people that just by the basic father-child relationship wanted the best for their children. When the company that I worked for went through a major management change and new managers came in, I found some terrific advocates in that group who simply wanted to find diverse perspectives and asked me to do very diverse things, things that I had never done, that sort of square the diversity element, a diverse member of the team doing something that's different for her as well. And that support was invaluable. And then when we started our bank, in a sense, I recruited my own advocates to be my initial shareholders and to be my initial board members. So having those advocates is really important. And understanding though that they all speak a different language. I remember one of the most supportive senior managers I ever had was shocked when I told him that I wanted a traveling job. I wanted this job running a Midwestern territory. And he kept trying to talk me into a job where New York City would be my territory so that I would only have to take a train and wouldn't have to be away from home overnight. And rather than be offended by his initial instincts, I took those as good intentions and explained to him that I was perfectly capable of getting on an airplane and finding a hotel room, let alone driving a rental car in the snow. But he was a believer and somebody who with good intentions could have hurt me back. But when I explained to him what I wanted, he was supportive 1,000%. And 15 years later, when I got a major promotion, he wrote back to me and told me how he admired, excuse this for the audience, how he had always admired my brass balls.
Oh, great. Hey, Mary Ann, let me share something personally based on what you just said. I'm the father of three adult daughters that all work in corporate America. And there was an article in Forbes online yesterday. It says, here's the title of the article. Want your daughter to go to the C-suite? Send her to a woman's college. So did either one of you attend a woman's college?
I did.
Where did you go, Mary Ann?
I went to what is now Seton Hill University in Western Pennsylvania, was at the time Seton Hill College. And I will tell you at the time, being a teenage girl, I wasn't always very happy there because it was a real pain in the neck to get to our brother's school and to actually see some guys every once in a while. But as I developed my own career, I realized it was incredibly invaluable training because in a woman's college, women do everything. And so you don't just read about the fact that women can do everything. You live that fact for 4 years. It was invaluable. Unfortunately, Jim, I'll have to look at that Forbes article. There aren't a lot of women's colleges left anymore.
That's correct. And that's what they cited actually in that article.
So I did not attend a women's
college. Schools. Go ahead, Cheryl.
I did not attend a women's college, but my daughter, my oldest daughter did attend Wellesley College, and it is one of the few. So Wellesley, Smith, Scripps in Southern California. I think Mills is still a women's college, and it was fantastic for her. It's not for everybody, I will say that, but it was fantastic for her. And just like you're saying, Mary Ann, women did everything. They have actually a very robust computer science program at Wellesley, who knew? And that's what she ended up doing. And it was great for her. So I agree, Jim, I think that's good. It's good advice. But being teenagers being what they are doesn't necessarily mean if you send them that they will actually go.
That's true. So my three daughters all went to a private girls high school, and they attended Spelman College, which is an all women's college in Atlanta, Georgia. So hopefully with this discussion, they're going to eventually get to the C-suite. So thank you for you.
So Jim, just as a very quick aside, I only have one child, a boy. and found myself ironically advocating for some of the disadvantages and implicit discrimination that young hyperactive boys have in school. I've always thought it was incredibly ironic. And I very intentionally sent him to a all boys high school.
Okay.
It was an invaluable experience for him.
Yeah, this article, I know this wasn't a part of our discussion, but it's good discussion. It highlighted that women that attended all women's colleges, they had better networks and they had better ways of connecting with people who were out and in the industry that were, you know, were fellow alumni, et cetera, et cetera. So I just thought that was very, very interesting. That's we're almost to the end.
For my daughter at Wellesley, her that network is unbelievable. Yeah. I don't know what your daughter's experience is with the Spelman network, but they are just there for each other for everything. It's amazing.
Same experience. All right, Chris, I'm going to bring you into the conversation. And this is a question for all. What are the action items for your organization / boards to continue the conversation of gender diversity?
Well, there's been a lot of great tactics already mentioned here, and I noted just a couple to touch on. And one, and these are both that I heard at different panel discussions, and they came from women CEOs of banks around the country. And one was keep an ongoing list of potential board members and work on that at all times. And I look back to when I was a board chair of a bank, a community bank, and I'm probably more typical than not. We know somebody is leaving in 2 months, and then 30 days before, you know, hey, is who do you know? And that you immediately gravitate to your immediate network of who you know and trust, rather than having an ongoing list, make it very purposefully, which is another word I've heard expressed here. And then another item that I heard from somebody, which I thought was interesting, is look at the time commitment that you need from your board members. And where this woman CEO was coming from is that there could be somebody, and this was mentioned before, that could be great community involvement. They might have a family, they might have a business, they have a great resume. They just can't put in the time that you want. So their point was to simplify the board governance, focus really on the high level management. Don't get down into the micro, which your staff should be doing. And allow that somebody who could be invaluable for your organization, but might not normally have the time to be a good candidate. So I'll just add those to all the other good comments.
Okay, thank you. Sherilyn?
Yeah, I think that's a great point, Chris, that being back to being intentional. So being intentional about this goal for your board and then keeping that list, keep renewing the list. That's certainly something that we do on the nonprofit board that I'm on, is we have a list of people that we're cultivating. And it might take a little time, or it might just not be the right time in somebody's life, to your point, that maybe they'd be a great candidate 2 or 3 years from now, but they're just not at a point in their life or career where they can contribute that kind of time. So I think the intentionality, keeping the list, casting the net broadly, which also takes time. You know, you aren't going to be able to fish in a new pond immediately. It's going to take some time to broaden that network. And then supporting people so they can be successful. I do think that's another thing that we haven't really talked about directly, is board training and board mentorship. I think that is super helpful, especially for somebody who maybe has only served on a nonprofit board or hasn't served on a board at all. And banks are extremely complicated. I know my first, you know, I come from financial services, and before my first board meeting, it took me hours to get through that board book because there was so much that I didn't know. I remember literally Googling, you know, I'm like, what does that mean? I don't even know what that means. So, I think having some formal training and some formal support from a mentor is extremely helpful. And that maybe doesn't have to be in place forever, but for the first year or so, until somebody kind of gets their feet under them, I think is really important too.
Okay, great. Marianne?
So I'll probably quickly repeat a couple of things, but maybe oversimplistically, I would say, you know, one thing to make sure that something gets attention at a board is to keep it on the agenda. And diversity should be on the agenda. I'm blessed again with a female governance chair. And so it's always part of the agenda. And being part of the agenda means it's also part of your strategic initiatives. And that's a way that it always reminds people, this is a conditioned precedent to a lot of the other strategic initiatives it has, whether it's revenue growth through reaching out to different markets, whether it's employee development, leadership pipelines, community branding. This is part and parcel of that. It's not something that hangs off to the side. So keep it on the agenda and keep it in your initiatives.
Okay, great. I have a question that I like to ask everybody, and it's kind of like a quick hit question. I led off our panel today with some statistics, and I would just like for you to think into the future. What do you think that percentage of females or women on a board eventually will evolve to? Just give me a number. And I'm gonna start with you, Marianne.
Well, eventually might be the operative word here, but I would say somewhere between 45 and 50%. In part because look at who most of our university graduates are. Look at who most of our first line managers are. With the right level of support, we should be able to reach the population mirror, right? So 45 to 50% eventually.
Okay. Sherilyn?
Yeah, I agree with that. I know there is actually an initiative, 50-50 women on boards. And I think it's a great goal. One other thing I maybe should have mentioned earlier, but I'll toss out there now, is I think the board sphere has changed a little bit, or is changing a little bit, that I think kind of the old way of thinking about boards is we only want sitting or retired CEOs. That's the qualification, is you have to be a sitting or retired CEO. And, you know, honestly, there just aren't very many women that are sitting or retired CEOs. So I think that's really the first thing that has to evolve. And fortunately, I think it has started to. First of all, retired is not as desirable as it used to be. Now it's more sitting. We want, you know, people who are active in their careers, which further limits the pool, frankly, because if you can't sit on four or five boards like you used to, then that means there have to be more people who are engaged. So I think the notion that you can be an effective board member and not be a CEO is kind of the first thing that has to break down, and has started to break down, that you can be a CFO like I am, or you can be have P&L responsibility for a major division in a big company. So I think all of that will help us get to our goal of having more women on boards.
Okay, fantastic. And Chris, I think you said you had 29 or 21 female direct reports.
Back in the banking. But most of those reports were not high level management type of people, somewhere.
Okay. So what do you think the percentage will be eventually? Do you think it'll be higher than 45%?
I think if we were at 30 to 40% sometime in the next 5 to 10 years, I would say that's huge strides. Maybe not where it should be, but that would be huge strides. And I'll just share something I found rather funny, but indicative of what's going on. So CBIZ won an award in our category for a publicly traded company in women diversity on the board. And as I was talking to one of our people about that, I said, but we only, at that time, we had 2 out of 11 people. So the threshold for an award in our publicly traded category in financial services was 15%. We were 18%. And so I thought, well, that's a very, very low threshold. That's today for us to receive recognition at 2 out of 11. So the bar is rather low right now, but I think there's just a lot of great things going on there. And will we hit the 50%? That's a great goal. If we hit 30 to 40 in 5 to 10 years, that's significant change. And I think that's doable.
Fantastic. Well, I'm getting the signal that our time is up. And so I'm going to close this out. you know, this has been a great panel, and to be best in class, I think it's critically important that we invest in opportunities to increase women at the C-suite leadership level and at the board level, but also have, and all of you have kind of talked about this, inclusive strategies to diversify boards of directors. In closing, you guys have been great. I'd just like to give you my own kind of round of applause for all of you. And I just really want to thank you for your time and your candid answers and the best practices. So thank you for participating in the session today.
Thanks, Jim.
Thanks, Jim.
Thank you.
Bye.
I'm going to turn it back over to you, Felicia.
Great. Thank you, Jim, and all of our panelists for that engaging discussion, the personal stories, the resources, and all of the information you shared was really great, and including the Nike phrase, just do it. Now we're going to take a few minutes for a special recognition from Bank on Women Incorporated. And for that, allow me to introduce you to Lori Bettinger. Lori is the co-president of Alliance Partners and serves as the president of Bank Alliance, a network of over 250 community banks located across the United States. Prior to joining Alliance Partners, Lori served as the director of the TARP Capital Purchase Program at the Department of the Treasury. Lori is also a member of the board of directors for Bank on Women Incorporated and will be presenting their special award for today. Lori, I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks so much, Felicia. Good afternoon. On behalf of Bank on Women, where I am honored to serve on the board of directors, I am delighted to announce that Lisa Lampkin-Broom, the Burton Craig Distinguished Professor and Director of the Center for Banking and Finance at the University of North Carolina School of Law, is this year's winner of the Bank on Women Champions Award. The Champions Award is given to the person who best responds to the call to action to educate the community banking industry on the importance of adding qualified women to the board and C-suite. In addition, the award seeks to recognize those who develop and promote women leaders in community banking, all with the goal of seeking to increase the number of qualified women serving on boards of directors and in executive management. A champion may be an executive, board chair, or board member, a legal or financial advisor to the banking industry, a member of the regulatory community, or a thought leader. It is someone who actively engages the banking community in discussions about the importance of gender diversity and promotes talented women in banking. Lisa Broom exemplifies a champion. In addition to her previously mentioned distinguished roles at the UNC School of Law, Lisa also founded and currently leads the Director of Diversity Institute. The objective of the DDI is to encourage boards of directors of public companies to increase their gender, racial, and ethnic diversity. The initiative provides training for those interested in corporate board service and maintains a database of potential diverse board of directors. The DDI was formed in 2003 at the suggestion of Henry Frey, the retired Chief Justice of the North Carolina Supreme Court and first African-American who served in that position, and Tom Ross, then the Executive Director of the Z. Smith Reynolds Foundation. If you care about board diversity, which I know everyone does, please make sure you follow them on LinkedIn as they have great content on this topic. And they also have regular spotlights on board positions filled by their DDI bootcamp alums. For these reasons and so many more, we are delighted and honored to name Lisa Broom as Bank on Women's winner of our 2021 Champions Award.
Well, thank you, Lori, for that generous introduction. And thanks to Bank on Women for this wonderful honor. You know, I've been in conversation with Terry Spiro and Jennifer Doherty about Bank on Women since it was just a gleam in their eyes. I've been so impressed with their energy and commitment to advancing women in community banking up the management ranks as well as in the boardroom. This conference, for instance, in its third year, is a tremendous example of the extraordinary impact that Bank on Women, alongside the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond, and the Risk Management Association are having on making increasing community bank gender diversity. I appreciate also that Lori provided the origin story for UNC School of Law's Director Diversity Initiative, but this group might find the pre-origin story of even greater interest. In fact, at the first year of this conference, I moderated a panel that teased out that story through panel participants Joe Smith and Jewel Hoover. As director of the Law School's Center for Banking and Finance, I worked with the North Carolina Commissioner of Banks Office on an annual Bank Directors College, a four-day program to introduce new bank directors to their duties as director, but also to provide them with an understanding of some of the unique aspects of being a bank director, given the high degree of state and federal regulation. Joan Smith, who was then serving as the Commissioner of Banks, said, "Our state bank boards are too male, pale, and stale. I'm tired of hearing when organizers come for a new charter and I ask about their board composition, why they don't have more diverse directors. They always say, we looked for them, but we can't find any. So Lisa, let's find some women and people of color in the urban areas where new banks are forming and invite them to attend the Director's College tuition free. That way, the next time someone trots out that tired old line, I can reach into my hip pocket and pull out a list of people who are already trained for and have shown their commitment to becoming a bank director." We had a number of successes from that effort. Indeed, one was the second panelist from 2019, Jewel Hoover. Jewel had retired as Deputy Comptroller for the Western District of the OCC. This is one crowd where I don't have to decode OCC and explain who they regulate. Joe asked her to attend the Director's College, not that she needed the training, but so he could say that she had shown her commitment to becoming a bank board member. She was subsequently asked to join the board of First Charter in Charlotte. It was later purchased by Fifth Third. She was moved to an advisory board position for a year post-merger and then asked in 2009 to join Fifth Third's board. She recently reached the board's retirement age, but the board asked her to stay on for an additional year, approving an exception to the retirement policy, quote, "because of her important ongoing contributions to the board, including her extensive regulatory knowledge and experience and her diverse perspective," close quote. So when Henry Fry and Tom Ross made their way to our dean's office in 2003 to ask the law school to supply some leadership around board diversity issues, the dean said, "Lisa's been working on that, let's call her in." And that's how DDI and its mission of board diversity among all companies, including banks, began. I'm pleased to report that since 2006, DDI has maintained a database of potential diverse directors that Lori referred to, and also has offered an annual board boot camp. Once in the pandemic, we learned how to use Zoom. And since June 2020, we've offered at least one monthly free short webinar to our database members and others who are interested in the virtual format. I hope some of you in attendance will register on the database, ask me to search the database when you are looking for candidates to add to your director pool, and we can search by location since I know it's important for banks to have directors who reside within their footprint, and also join us for some of our programs. The only one we charge for is the annual boot camp held in May, and it is modestly priced compared to similar offerings by other groups. Just this calendar year, we have been requested to add diverse nominees for consideration for board service at 30 companies, including publicly traded companies, private corporations, and significant nonprofits. Moreover, we've had some pretty good placement success. For instance, in the searches we did in 2020, we are aware of four public company board members being placed and one private company board placement. Many of the folks who have attended our boot camp and other programs have also found success, and we profile as many of these board members as we learn about on our successes page. So thank you for this opportunity to tell you more about DDI. All of the resources that I mentioned and more are available on our website, ddi.law.unc.edu. And you can link from there to our LinkedIn page and follow us there as well. So Terry, Jen, Lori, and all those from Bank on Women, thank you for this wonderful award and this very nifty glass emblem. But more importantly, thank you for the work you are doing to elevate women in banking.
Round of applause, virtual round of applause. Congratulations, Lisa, and thank you, Lori, for that introduction. On behalf of the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond and our planning partners, Bank on Women Incorporated and the Risk Management Association, we'd like to thank all of you for attending our third annual banking symposium. I'd also like to extend a very special thanks to our speakers over the last 3 days, our planning and events staff who are working just tirelessly behind the scenes, our advisors and our executive sponsor, Lisa White at the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond, who all helped to make this symposium possible and a great event. We really hope that you all have obtained some great information, some good guidance, some wonderful resources, and made some great connections so that you can take action to ensure you're part of the solution as we continue to work to improve gender diversity in the boardroom and C-suites in the financial services industry. Please watch out for an email that you will be receiving shortly. It will ask you to take a short survey to ensure that we can continue to provide this great event in the future, and we'll basically incorporate all of your responses and helpful suggestions. The business case has been made. Now we have to take action. Be intentional. Take care and have a good evening.